Well, welcome in once again, everybody, to another edition of the 19th Hole Podcast for Golfers. I'm your host, Dennis Silvers, and we've got a wonderful show for you. We've got somebody very special in studio. And before we go any further, I wish that everybody enjoyed a very, very wonderful Christmas. You got everything you wanted from your Christmas list. Santa was very good to you. Brought you, you know, about six dozen new golf balls, new set of clubs, whatever. We've got some great weather now going in Las Vegas, so hopefully you'll get out, try to break in those new clubs, and just have a great time and looking forward to a very happy, healthy new year for everybody. And everybody's New Year's resolution, I'm going to make a lot of birdies in 2024, no three putts, a lot of birdies, a lot of pars. So you're just going to have to work on your game a little bit, but hope next year brings you a lot of golf to get out and play. And that's what it's all about. Got big time, as you know, everybody watching knows that New Year's in Las Vegas is unlike any other, with all the fireworks on top of the properties, and the streets are just absolutely packed, both on the Strip as well as downtown Las Vegas. So it should be another spectacular welcoming to 2024. Anyway, let me tell you about our special guest that we have on the show today. So happy to have him in studio. Chris Matthews is the Channel 8 Sports Director. He joined 8 News Now, KLAS, Channel 8 here in Southern Nevada in 1997. He is also a sports reporter and director as well. Chris has served in various other markets as a sports director before coming to Las Vegas, like Arkansas, like Idaho Falls, and in the Big Apple in New York. Chris covers all of our sports teams here in Las Vegas, including UNLV, of course. Chris has won numerous awards and recognitions throughout his broadcasting career. He's also an Emmy Award-winning sportscaster. That's pretty good. We don't get too many Emmy Award nothing in here. And it's great to have them. Chris and the sports department at KLAS Channel 8 continue to dominate the sports market here in Southern Nevada. And we're going to find out why. I've got my own idea as to why. And Chris, welcome to the show. So glad you're here.
Oh, Dennis, thank you very much for the invite. Hey, appreciate that. Merry Christmas to you.
Merry Christmas to you and your family.
Holiday as we roll into 2024.
It's here. It's hard to believe, but it's here.
It's gone.
You've covered just about every sport here throughout your career. So let me ask you this. Do you have a favorite that you cover? And why?
Probably college football. I really like college football. I like the NFL, obviously. That's always a lot of fun. Probably, yeah. College football, though. It's nice to see the UNLV football program finally turning a corner, it seems. And why not? I mean, they've got all the facilities to make it happen.
Absolutely.
To achieve success. Yeah. You play at the best stadium in the country. You have some of the nicest facilities. And so there's no reason. And now with the NIL, where you can pay players to come play, and the transfer portal, there's no reason why UNLV should ever be out-recruited by any Mountain West team. I'm not talking about the entire country, but any Mountain West team, there's no reason why UNLV football shouldn't be number one on a recruits list if you're talking Mountain West. That's fun. Yeah, I mean, you've been around a long time, Dennis.
And what a year they've had, UNLV. My gosh.
Yeah, unfortunately, they finished off with those three straight losses, San Jose, Boise, and then the bowl game. But still, you know, 9 wins. Who would have guessed that going into the season? So a lot of fun to cover, you know, the football team and just to see the growth. I was over at the One Vegas event over at Allegiant Stadium last, I think it was the 23rd, mm-hmm. and I ran into Jeff Horton, Who was the coach when I got here in 96. And he was talking about the old times. I thought, man, how different it would be had you been the coach now from when you were there. You're playing out at Sam Boyd with no facilities and nothing.
No kidding.
Yeah, so it was nice to run into him. And it really is great to see that football program flourish and kind of build and get going. And that's fun stuff. Yep.
Unreal. They give them a lot of credibility. Hardest part about being a sports reporter or anchor?
The hardest part? Trying to fit. Here's the thing, which is now crazy. When I first got here, we would do some national stories and maybe some national scores, mm-hmm. baseball mm-hmm. scores, whatever. Now the hardest thing is trying to decide what we can fit in those 3 or 3.5 minutes because there's so much going on. Right. I rarely have to do a national story, even a regional story for that matter anymore, because there's so much going on here that you can fill 3 minutes just easy. Like that. So what now? Another challenge is trying to find those unique stories because you got to cover the Knights, you got to cover the Raiders, you want to cover the UNLV football programs, you got UFC, you got boxing, you got all these things, but there's also some real cool stories behind those major stories that would appeal to everybody, like that would appeal to your girlfriend, my wife, the person down the road. You want to try to do all that stuff, so that's the biggest challenge is trying to appeal and put together a sports cast that everyone will enjoy.
Yeah. Speaking of challenges, how do you handle any deadlines that you might come across, that you might have? Like you say, because there's so much going on.
The deadlines. We just get it done. I mean, when you talk about deadlines, if we know we're going to be in the 4, we come in, we get it done. If we're going to be in the 5, we come and get that done. Yeah. 6, the 11. I mean, we have to have stuff done because that's the hole we're filling in the sportscast. So we just get it done. That's just the thing.
Yeah. No, you got to do it.
Yeah, I mean, there's no like, hey, can you fill in? No, you just go out and do it. Yeah,
You do. How do you, with everything that's going on, not only in Las Vegas, but nationwide, really worldwide? How do you guys stay up to date on what's transpiring in the world of sports?
Well, you know, I read a lot. I read the papers. Try to stay up to date. Now, I used to be kind of probably maybe a little bit more up to date with the national sports mm-hmm. news because mm-hmm. we would cover that kind of stuff. But now we try to stay up to date, obviously, with our local stuff. And then, we know what's going on in Major League Baseball. Ohtani signs with the Dodgers or hey, guess what? The Trevor Lawrence might not play this week because he still has in concussion mm-hmm. protocol. So we try to stay up to date, just read a lot, find out a lot. You look on the web. Try to just stay up to date with these other markets because, hey, if we have an NFL team, we want to know what the Indianapolis Colts are doing. Is Minshew, is he healthy? Is he going to play? Jonathan Taylor? So, I mean, there's our stories, but then there's our stories behind those stories because we're going to be covering teams that are going to be playing the teams that we play. The Golden Knights, for example, who play the LA Kings tonight, they have a big game. They've lost 4 in a row, which isn't good, but they have the Kings in Las Vegas, and the Kings have the best road record in the National Hockey League, 13-1-1, so they're really hot. But now can the Knights, who were probably kind of not playing so well, and the goalies are hurt, and Logan Thompson got shelled last night in Anaheim, can the goalies step up and make a difference tonight when you got the LA Kings rolling? And for the first time, the Golden Knights are not in first place in the division. Vancouver has jumped, and they're 2 points ahead. So everybody's like, whoa, what's going on with the Vegas Golden Knights?
Yeah, because everybody here expects a lot from them.
As does the owner, Bill Foley.
As does the owner.
Bill Foley is like, he demands that these players, always advancing, never retreating. That's his mantra. Yeah. And, you appreciate that. Look what they've done with that.
Incredible.
Yeah.
It is incredible how the Golden Knights or people that live here have just gravitated to this team, and rightfully so. They're a great sports team. They play in a great facility. They practice in a very good facility, both here and the one in Henderson. And they do a lot for the community, and that is great.
Yeah, and it was a magical time. I mean, we talk about everybody gravitates to the Knights. First of all, they didn't come in from somewhere else. They were born here, that's a difference.
Right. Good point.
You had the tragedy that surrounded the Golden Knights right when they first got here, the shooting. And so that was just a gigantic tragedy. But the Golden Knights, remember how they got out into the community, giving blood, helping those. So, I mean, they kind of just endeared themselves to this community like no other franchise probably ever will, right off the bat with that tragedy. So they kind of, they became our team. Right. You know, picture there.
Yeah.
That's our guy. Those are our guys. But now there's only a handful of misfits left from that first team. So that's a little different. So we'll see what happens. I mean, there'll be ups and downs, but Bill Foley always wants the ups.
Absolutely.
And he's paying for the ups. So
he is.
I mean, he's shelling out to make this team a constant winner and build a dynasty. So
Bill, you gotta make sure you sell a lot of wine.
He will not sell a lot of wine.
You gotta sell a lot of shirts in that armory, man. Let me tell
exactly,
you.
Exactly, yes.
Man, but
who's your favorite player on the Knights team?
Oh.
Do you have a favorite?
I really don't. I just enjoy watching all of them.
My first interview, live interview, right when they first got here. Of course, it's changed now because you just can't do what we did. We walked right down outside the locker room. They brought him out. Right. But it was Jonathan Marchessault.
Oh, really?
So he's my favorite player. If you had to say, Chris, who's your favorite? Probably Jonathan Marchessault.
Yeah, that's a good one.
If you're going to have a favorite,
he's a
gritty, hard player.
Yeah.
Pulls no punches. We'll tell it like it is. We either, hey, we played crappy, we played well, we did this. These guys got to get better.
Right.
I mean, he pulls no punches. Right. I like that attitude.
Yeah, I do too. How do you explain, we talked a little bit about this before we went on, but how do you explain the explosion of sports teams here that have made Las Vegas their home? Sure, we all know that Vegas has a certain genre, certain attraction, but how do you, these teams wanting to come over, make Vegas their home, spending a lot of money here,
you know why it's happening?
How do you explain that?
Here's why it's happening. Bill Foley broke the mold.
Yeah.
Or the glass, whatever. Because he said, let's try it. So remember when he first thought about, hey, I'm going to bring a pro franchiser. Now, you always had the AAA baseball. So that's been here forever.
Forever.
But major sports, Bill Foley said, you know what? We're going to pull the community. We're going to see if they're interested. We'll see. And you know, on all the analytics and all that proved, hey, Las Vegas could probably fit for a major sports franchise. So he did all that, and it's worked out. But now the crazy thing, and then you get 42 million visitors here a year. So they're saying to themselves, wow, that's constant success if you can build a winner
right
with all these visitors. So what that's they've right. done is they've come in here, and Las Vegas is what Las Vegas is, the sports and entertainment capital of the world. So already Bill Foley, who had to put $500 million down to be part of the NHL, he's doubled his franchise value. Mark Davis, who brought his team, it's only been a handful of years, when it arrived in Las Vegas, I think it was worth $3.3 or $3.7 billion. Now it's worth $6.8 billion.
Wow.
So that's why I'm saying the NBA will certainly be following the A's. I think the NBA will be here before the A's because they'll get this arena done and they'll get that going. And the NBA will say, as soon as their TV deal is done, okay, it's time to bring an NBA franchise here. Because the other owners in the league, if you and I are owners and we have a couple other guys that are owners, we're saying, wow, our whole league increases in value with having Vegas in our league. You want to get a team here as soon as possible.
That's a very
And that's
very
why
good
LeBron
point.
James is all excited about, hey, I want to be a part owner of that team in Vegas.
That's very good. I'm going to have to get Miriam Adelson on the show.
And yes.
Talk about the Las Vegas Mavericks. Come on. Come up with something more unique than Las Vegas Mavericks, please. Okay. That was really a shock for a lot of people.
Well, I mean, probably the shock is that why wouldn't she invest in something that's going to happen in Vegas as opposed to the Dallas Mavericks?
I totally agree.
But there's probably enough investors out there that say, I'm interested in Vegas and I want to be part of the Vegas NBA franchise, which there will be a ton of interest because the value increases so quickly.
Yeah.
Like the A's, when John Fisher brings his A's here, immediately the value of that franchise increases. It's just because of the magic of Vegas.
Yeah.
So if I was him, I'd...
That's going to be some ballpark, too, and they finished that. Whoa.
I'm waiting to see the new renderings. Remember, they had a press conference a couple weeks prior to Christmas. They canceled it because of the tragedy over at UNLV, and they haven't rescheduled that thing yet. So I'm kind of waiting to see these new. But from what I hear,
it's gonna be gorgeous.
Have you everybody in their minds, picture the Sydney Opera House. You know what it looks like.
Yeah.
from what I understand, it's going to kind of look like that.
Really?
Like that. So that's going to be pretty cool.
I love it.
Yeah.
It's going to be absolutely awesome. Pretty soon you're not going to know what hat to buy.
Buy them all.
Buy them all. You know, the Golden Knights and
Raiders.
Raiders and
Aviators.
Have a plethora.
Your UFC fighter.
That's right. You're going to have a plethora of choices for shirts, for hats, for stickers, you know, and I don't know. I'm going to have to call Don Logan and get Donnie in here and you know, talk about the Aviators and stuff. Donnie's a great guy.
Oh, he's a terrific guy.
He's been in there such a long time. All right, I tell you what. Chris Matthews is our special guest here on 19th Old Podcast, and we're going to step away right now. We've got to take a short break. We'll come back. We'll have a lot more with Chris. So stay with us. We're back right after this. Welcome back, everybody, to more of the 19th Old Podcast. I'm your host, Dennis Silvers, here with Chris Matthews, the sports director for KLAS Channel 8 here in Southern Nevada. What's more impactful, Chris, and why, doing an interview out of the studio, doing a live shot, or in studio? The key word being impactful.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Impactful. Well, in studio, if we had somebody in studio, we'd certainly be able to have more time with
them.
Oh,
sure.
If we had somebody on it, because we have these shows, we have the Launa Sports Wrap that we do,
right.
Usually on Sundays, but it's coming out of any big CBS sporting event. So that's usually a half hour, could be an hour.
Could be an hour.
So we could get in somebody and talk for 10 minutes as opposed to a live shot where you're only talking. Let's take, for example, this. We had the Cowboys for the NFR come in. We had two Cowboys come in, tie down roper and a saddle bronc rider. We were able to talk to these two Cowboys for 10 minutes about how they grew up, what they're doing, their businesses, their hobbies outside. If we were doing a live shot with them, we'd literally have a minute and a half. How's the NFR? Are you excited about this year? And then we'd be, okay, good luck to you, and then we'd be done.
Right.
But see, now we can kind of give our viewers a little peek into their background, what they're all about, what they're like.
Yeah.
In fact, you know what? His wife, the tie-down guy, his wife from Louisiana, his wife was a barrel racer. Well, that's kind of cool.
Really?
They both competed
cool.
in the NFR. So while the husband and wife, I don't know how many husband and wives actually do that, but we're in studio with a Launa Sports Wrap or our Sunday night show. It just seems like we have more time. To have fun with a guest. So I like those a lot.
Yeah.
You know, we can bring him in and spend more time. Kevin Kruger, if we had him in talking Runner Rebel basketball, we could talk about all his individual players, how they're building the program. If it was a live shot, we would be able to ask him, hey, what do you think of next opponent?
I know.
And then we're out.
You're a little pressed for time. I know.
Exactly.
Yeah. And especially with the rodeo, you got the horse pushing you out of the way, you know. Are players from a particular sport harder to interview than another sport? In other words,
I'm going
to have a tougher time.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, for example,
I'll tell you the
with
easiest,
a hockey player as opposed to
an NFL player.
An NFL player, right.
It's getting so, I'm going to say the NASCAR, probably the NHRA, the hot rod guys, the Top Fuel and the funny car, those guys are by far the easiest going, meet us anywhere. Yeah,
really?
come over to our stall. We'll talk to you. Oh, what's happened really, and I don't know, it's just what it is. Society and the players' time, and there's so much more media now that really in the NFL, the NHL, they'll throw a couple players in the locker room, you get them, and mm-hmm. you're done. Mm-hmm. You can't go this guy, and it's kind of the sad thing is really you can't really. I'm going to talk to all the running backs and do a story on all the running backs and how different they are, because you just can't do that anymore. They don't give you all the running backs.
Right.
Me, you know, they'll give you a couple players, a podium player. Couple players in the locker room, the coach at the podium, and that's it. Golden Knights, when they first got here, they'd have about 6-7 players come into the it's not the play. They have two separate locker rooms, the Golden Knights. The locker room where all their personal stuff is and all that. Then they have another locker room where they just kind of come in and meet in between periods. So that locker room after the game, they used to have probably 6-7 players that come in there. We could talk to all these players. Marc-Andre Fleury and just whoever it was right off the bat, you know, the first couple of years. But now they'll bring maybe a couple players in there. You got the coach and you're done. You don't have the ability to do in-depth interviews and stories with those players after games like we used to. But really, NHRA, those guys are terrific.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Oh, those guys are just great.
Didn't know that.
And ladies. They had a couple. There's a couple ladies now in the sport that are doing
That's true.
Brittany Force and I can't remember the other lady, but there's some really talented drivers in the NHRA.
That is good to know. How did you start at Channel 8? What brought you to them or them to you when decided to come down to Vegas?
I just always wanted, I just kind of wanted to get closer to home. Grew up in Salt Lake, went to the University of Utah, graduated. Proud Ute, by the way. But then I just, all the family was out west. So we were back in upstate New York, and I thought, let's try to get back somewhere. And so we came back here and just had 3-year contracts. And I always thought, this is kind of fun. I wonder if we'll stay here. And then kind of just, 3 turned into 6, turned into 9, turned into 12. And then we just build our lives here. Now it's the greatest. It's so fun to see how this city has changed from when I got here.
Yes, yes.
To now, not just talking resorts and all that, but just how the sports dynamic has changed. So that's been fun.
Oh, I'll bet it have.
Yeah.
And you guys, you and Ron have been on top of it. Why do you think, Chris, that the other affiliates here, and I won't mention them by name out of courtesy, they are, in my opinion and other people, they are very short when it comes to sports reporting? You guys are on top of it. You do in-depth stories. You cover it very, very well. And I'm not saying that because you're here now, but you do. You without a doubt have the best team in Southern Nevada for reporting sports. The other guys don't. It seems like it's an afterthought.
Well, here's what I'm thankful
especially
for.
When it comes to golf.
Let's talk about that. Here, I think this is the reason how TV has kind of changed a little bit. I guess it's management. What they've decided to do is at another station, you might have one sports reporter covering this sport. You might have another sports reporter covering that. You might have one covering that. So basically, they'll use three guys men and women to cover one sport.
Mm-hmm.
There's not really a traditional sports cast like we do at Channel 8 anymore, really, when you think about it. The others kind of do a specific sport, and through the course of the newscast, they'll throw this in, throw that in, whatever. But we have, thank goodness for Nexstar, we have a sports cast at a specific time where people can say to themselves, oh, that's right, at 6:20, I want to see what happened to the Knights, Rebels, and the Raiders.
Right.
And we'll have all those stories. They don't have to wait, oh, man, I wonder when the Raiders story. I missed the Raiders story. Oh, I missed the Golden Knights story. God, when was that story on? It's just always around.
Yeah.
But people know that our 6 and 11 will be there at 6:20, we'll be there at 11:20.
Right.
And I'm thankful
cover
for
it
that.
All.
We try to cover it all.
We have
Speaking
of golf, we have a very exciting event coming here the week of February 5th, which happens to be, Super Bowl week, which is on, you know, that Sunday.
On CBS, by the way.
On CBS. I was going to get that in.
I want to make sure we got that in.
And the Live Tour is here. They're playing out at Las Vegas Country Club. And it's going to be the first event for the number three player in the world, Jon Rahm, who, as you know, made big-time headlines with all the money he got from the Live Tour and a lot of other great, great players, which is going to be very, very exciting. What's your view on that and the Live Tour in general? What do you think they need? What do you think they're lacking? I mean, they're getting more popular.
It'll take a generation, like anything, I think.
You think so?
Yeah, I think it'll take a while. You get, you know, you slowly get those players coming over, and like, well, yeah, what's the latest with the two merging? There was talk the two were going to merge and be one. And you can play this and play that, which I think they should still do. I mean, how great would it be? I don't mind.
It's going to happen.
Yeah, it's got to happen, right? It's got to happen. I like the fact that you got some big names playing in the Live Tour. I'm excited about covering this Live event coming up on Super Bowl week.
Right.
It's going to be something else we can do, something else we can cover. You got some name players coming in here.
Yeah, you do.
Hopefully they all play. You know, Dennis Johnson, I mentioned Rahm, Phil Mickelson. I hope they all say, "Yeah, I'm going to go play in Vegas."
Yeah.
I hope they do.
I hope they all come.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be a lot of fun to see that. I hope they get some people out there. There was an article in the Review Journal a couple of days ago as far as ticket prices, which are going to be pretty near what they get for the Shriners event at TPC Summerlin, which is not a lot at all. So we're hoping that a lot of people go out, look at these guys up close and personal, and experience what a Live Tour event is all about. You know, the music and the being very casual.
Do you like the team play?
Boy.
See, I don't really like that.
To be honest, perfectly honest with you, I think that could be improved upon.
Yeah. And they only play 54 holes,
They only
right?
play 54.
Do you like that?
So they got to keep the pedal to the metal if that's the case. They still got to make putts, still got to hit the shots.
Yeah.
But a lot of people don't. And the people that are kind of down on the Live Tour are more the traditionalists. They're only playing 54 holes. Oh, God, they got all this music going. Oh, they got all this noise. Oh, they're playing in shorts and blah, blah, blah. Well, that's what's making it different. And you mentioned it before. I know there are a number of really, really good players that are currently playing on the PGA Tour that are kind of in line, that are kind of on the fence.
Oh, yeah.
Whether to jump ship, so to speak. But I think as far as the merger, that's as far as an agreement that they have, as soon as they get all the litigation out of the way, and I'm very good friends with the attorney that's heading all this litigation, it's going to happen. Yeah.
What will a typical week look like then? Will they try to combine? Will the PGA change and adopt some of the Live ideas?
They've got to. They've already started with all of the money that they're throwing at certain no-cut events.
Yeah.
And they only could keep that up for so long. You don't ever have to worry about the Saudis running out of money, ever, because that's never going to happen. But with the PGA Tour, that's a different story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why? If I equate that to boxing and the UFC, Dana White came in, videos, music, all the excitement, and the big, you know, the big video walls and all that stuff. He brought a bunch of new fans to the sport.
Yeah.
Basically, to combat sports. Boxing was kind of just kind of old school, just run the fighters out there and fight without making a big production.
Right.
But see, now boxing has now kind of adopted some of the UFC's ideas. So I think that's what the PGA needs to do.
I agree.
It's the future of the sport.
I agree.
Well, it's like baseball. It's like the clock on the mound. How can you put a clock on a pitcher? Well, you got to speed the game up because who's playing baseball out here with garbage cans and base paths and the kids in a park? Nobody is. So you got to change the sport. You got to adapt it to the. You got to just draw interest to it.
Absolutely.
I don't see. I never see kids out playing baseball just at a park.
Really?
With. You know, this bag is second base. The tin can is the home plate. You know what I mean? That's what we used to do. You would set up the base plan. You don't see that. You don't see it anymore.
Yeah.
So I think you got to – and the attention span now, we're all guilty because we have our phones, right?
Right.
Our attention span is like this now.
Correct.
I want to be entertained right now.
Correct.
You know?
So I want it now. That's true.
Yeah. If you can do things that keep people interested for a shorter amount of time – and they get to see the stars, they get to see whoever, but it doesn't you're not sitting there for 3 hours.
You've got to separate yourself from your competition. I say that with everything. And Liv has come out, they're doing something different. And whenever you try something different, it's not going to be accepted, you know, all that easily. But, you know, in the meantime, they're surviving. They do need help, I think, with television time. I mean, the CW is okay, but they have to expand it.
Let me plug the CW because Nexstar now owns the CW, the same company that owns Channel 8. So they're trying to expand this thing and get more eyeballs on the
CW. Good
for
them,
you know.
Good for them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
because it's here. There's no doubt. All right. Tell you what, we're going to step away, take another short break. We come back, we'll finish up with Mr. Chris Matthews, sports director for Channel 8. Be right back.
As golfers, we want instant gratification when it comes to a better golf swing and playing better golf. Impossible, you say? Not anymore. Golf Boost Artificial Intelligence, AI, has developed and patented the most advanced swing analysis technology in golf. Simply, the algorithms detect your body position and then analyze your golf swing using their artificial intelligence technology. The AI captures all the relevant data from your swing video and then presents you a personalized lesson. Golf Boost AI is the ultimate swing analysis and virtual instruction system for golfers of all ages and abilities. This sophisticated software takes into consideration your height and build, playing level, and returns the ideal solution for your swing. Bottom line, Golf Boost AI is an incredibly convenient and cost-effective tool for golfers to improve their swing. Go to golfboost.com and check it out. The app is free to download and try. Visit golfboost.com today.
One of the perks about being in golf media is that I get to try every club ever made. Of course, like most things, some are better than others. I'm here to tell you that I have found unquestionably the absolute best performing set of irons I have ever played, and my scores show it. Let me introduce you to Grindworks, custom fitted irons that are made to fit your game. Grindworks offers players three different styles of irons. You can choose muscle back irons, cavity back irons, and even blades along with some awesome wedges. And when you purchase your clubs, Grindworks lets you choose the type of shaft you want, the type grip you prefer, and even will adjust the loft and lie of your clubs if needed. That's unheard of. So what are you waiting for? Feel the power and experience and performance of these amazing clubs. Simply go to grindworksusa.com or call 281-651-4046 to order. Trust me, your handicap will love you for it. All right, welcome back, everybody. I told you we would be back in short order. Having a great conversation with Chris Matthews here. We were talking about the LIV event coming to the Country Club. And I had said, Chris, that, and I've played the Country Club a number of times, and I really enjoy playing it out there. I'm good friends with the architect, Mark Rayford, who redid the the course, and I think he made it a shot or two tougher. But I think for these guys at their level, they're going to not have any problem handling it. I think you're going to see some great scores out there.
You're talking about the winner guys. Being 20, 21 under.
I'm telling you. I'm telling you. Somebody gets a putter going, and you're going to see that. Speaking about that, sort of, that was not a great transition. But what do you think about the RNA and the USGA wanting to roll back the ball? People I know don't like it at all.
Why is that?
Tour players don't like it. Other people in golf media don't like it. A lot of people in the industry don't like it. The ball manufacturers, the people that make clubs, they just think it's unnecessary. And I think these guys have trained all of their life to really hit the ball far, and they do. And they say, oh, it makes these courses obsolete and this and that. And I don't buy that for a minute. You still got to hit the shots. You still got to make the putts. And I think it's going to hurt, obviously, the amateur players more than the professionals are not going to have a problem with it at all. But
I wonder how it would affect how would it affect a guy like you, let's say.
I need every yard that I could get, you know. All right. So it's 10 yards again for the professionals at nothing, but for the weekend amateurs, it could add up to be something. So leave the amateurs alone, let them play the ball they want, and let's make one ball for the tour. Everybody plays the same ball. So there's no hanky-panky, and again, I don't think it's going to make a darn bit of difference, you know, for the professionals, but they've got to redo everything, and I don't know.
How fun would it be if you could play a tournament, like one tournament somewhere every year where those who want to come play and have fun, I don't know if anybody would, but you go back to the go back to the 60s or late 50s with clubs, with irons, yeah. With all the gear, with the balls,
yeah.
With the distances.
Right.
And, you know, see what these players could do. Like, could they match up with a
right.
Snead or a Ben Hogan? Or,
right.
I mean, it'd be kind of fun.
Yeah, it would be fun.
I always thought it'd be also fun in today's golf if they had one tournament. And it's kind of like that in Arizona, in Phoenix, the waste management.
Yeah.
Where they have that big gallery. But
right.
How fun would it be if you could, come on, Tiger, or come on, you know, whatever, where you could actually yell during the putts. But and you knew that going in, that you could have a loud
right.
gallery.
Right.
You didn't have to be silent. It'd just be kind of interesting to see how these players would react
would.
To people cheering, yeah. You know, talking during their
Some swings. Would handle it. Some would hate it.
Yeah.
But try
but
it.
But it'd be different.
It would be different.
And if you don't want to play, you don't play it. But you know going right. in that you can have a loud gallery that they can
exactly.
talk during your swing.
Or if they're on the green, they take the putter back to make a putt. All of a sudden, this music comes out and starts blaring.
It would be fun to see.
It would be, yeah, it'd be interesting to, you know, to see their reaction on that. I think that's a good idea.
Well, you know what? Women's basketball, the WNBA, they have music throughout the entire game.
Right.
It's going, bum, 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 whether on offense, defense. It's not like it's quiet and then the music comes during a break or whatever. They have music throughout,
all the time.
All the time.
Yeah.
WNBA makes it
Talk
fun.
Talk to us about our new team that we got here.
The volleyball?
The volleyball.
Volleyball is going to be interesting. They're going to play at the Dollar Loan Center. Was it a 16-game schedule? I can't remember the exact schedule, but
really,
they got some really talented players. It's going to be women's volleyball at the Dollar Loan Center.
In Henderson.
The Vegas Thrill is the name.
The Vegas Thrill.
So that's going to be kind of fun. I'm excited to see what it's all about and how many people will embrace this team. I didn't see what the numbers were for the Desert Dogs. Their season is back. The indoor lacrosse team, they're right. back for a second year.
And a lot of people like lacrosse.
Yeah,
a lot
Gretzky
of people
and
like
who
lacrosse.
Else? He's Dustin Johnson, Wayne Gretzky, mm-hmm. and the Cy, the owner of the Brooklyn Nets, is part of the ownership here. So it's gonna, we'll see what happens with that women's volleyball. That's going to be interesting. We'll
yeah.
see. Yeah.
You've got to be tall if you want to try out for the team. You got to be tall.
That's right.
And you got to be limber. For those dunks, baby.
The kills, the smashes.
Yeah, for the kills.
Yeah, that's right.
It's going to be very, very interesting. How is it? Let me wrap up with this and kind of put you on the spot a little bit. I know what you're going to say.
Well, I'm excited about your golf minute. I want to see your golf minute come up.
You're going to see it in about a minute or two.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, do you have to take one more break before?
We have to take a short one.
Okay.
We got to take a very short one. Yeah, I'm getting the signal from there. All right, I'll tell you what. Let's take another short break, and we'll come back. We'll show you the golf minute that Chris just alluded to. So stay with us. It's worth sticking around. And
okay, I want to see.
Hopefully, it's going to help your game. All right, we'll be right back, everybody. Hi, I'm Dennis Overs, host of the 19th Hole Podcast for Golfers, and I'm here to tell you about some great wedges and putters from Grindworks USA. First, the Grindworks Barrett Collection Wedge Set. These wedges are unparalleled in today's market. The wedges come to you in three different lofts, 51, 57, and 61 degrees, all designed to be able to spin around the greens with the ability to hit high, middle, or low shots around the greens. Grindworks also makes a line of their Windsor Wells Precision Machine Putters. This beautiful design of putter was not only created to be appealing to the eye, but to perform better on the greens. You will gain a ton of confidence to help lower your scores. Go to grindworksusa.com or call 281-651-4046. I promise your scores will love you for it. All right, welcome back, everybody. Having a great time here with Chris Matthews. And as we talked about a little before, we're going to close out the show with the Golf Minute, and we hope this little tip is going to help your game. So take a look at it right now. Hi, everybody. I'm Dennis Silvers for 8 News Now with another Golf Minute. I'm with longtime LPGA teaching professional Karen Dunphy at a very iconic golf course, Las Vegas National. And Karen, as you know, most golfers hate slicing the ball. They want to learn how to curve the ball either right to left or left to right. What's your best advice for them on how to do that?
You know, finding fairways and hitting greens are really the backbone of playing good golf. So I have the alignment sticks on the ground to tell me whether or not my club is coming straight or a swiping motion. If I make this kind of motion, that ball's going to curve left. So just to demonstrate here, I will make this ball curve to the right. There she goes. So we shouldn't really shy away from curving the ball. We should learn how to make the ball curve the way we want.
Thank you, Karen. Great information for people to learn how to curve the ball when they want. For the Golf Minute, I'm Dennis Silvers, and we'll see you all back next time. So long. All right. Thank you, Karen Dunphy, longtime LPGA
teacher. I need that tip.
Teacher.
Thank you very much. I need that tip.
I'm going to send it to you. We all need that tip. This series of the Golf Minutes are specifically designed for different parts of your game to take or not take, but you should take it because they're all given by very, very good longtime teaching professionals around town. So we can all use help. You're not playing a lot of golf these days.
I'm waiting for your invite. I'm just waiting patiently.
Oh, you hear this? You hear
waiting
this?
Waiting patiently
okay.
for your invite.
Okay. Well, you and I, and we'll get a few trail out.
Okay.
And he's a left-hander, by the way.
As am I.
As you. That's right, you are.
Yeah.
I forgot.
Yeah.
I forgot.
Yeah.
Okay.
You forget the bad golfers.
No, we don't forget the bad golfers. Oh, so real quickly, to wrap up the show, what do you foresee in 2024 sports-wise going on in Las Vegas? We know we got F1 coming back.
I think the Aces will battle for another championship. They're third. Okay. That's going to be interesting. It's going to be fun with NASCAR. I think the Runner Rebel basketball program still needs some work. I'm excited for the Barry Odom year two. Football, yeah. The Golden Knights will make the playoffs. I don't know if they'll reach the Stanley Cup final, but I say they of course, they'll make the playoffs. I think they're just too good not to. And we'll find out more about the A's, which I'm excited about, and more about the NBA and the new arena. This will be a little tease. The new arena on the Strip and Blue Diamond. The big complex out there they're going to build. So we'll have a lot more coming 2024.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be a busy time next year for sports here in Las Vegas. A lot of different types of team, and support them and go, and they need support. And go Rebels,
yeah.
As always. All right. Chris, thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you. I appreciate the invite.
For your time.
Thank you very much.
This is
thank
a
you.
Busy guy, and we're very lucky to have him in studio. We're going to do it again sooner or later, and we want to wish everybody looking in a very happy, healthy New Year's, a great 2024, and get out and play some golf when you can, and get out to that live event also if you can. Before you know it, the Shriners is going to be here, so we need another PGA Tour event here as well. That would be great to have it here in Las Vegas. So until then, we're going to be back same place, same time next week, everybody. So for Chris, I'm Dennis Silvers. So long, everybody. We'll see you then.